Good morning and welcome to worship. I'm Robin Jacobson and I'm speaking from Trinity United Church in Vernon, British Columbia. We meet on the unceded territory of the Okanagan Silk people. We've all been so deeply touched and moved by these horrific events that have happened in Nova Scotia over this past week. Our prayers and thoughts are with the families of the 22 victims, those who have been killed, those who have been injured, as well as all of those who have known and who have loved this deeply disturbed killer. We think especially of them now as they are unable to come together in order to be able to express their grief as a result of these pandemic restrictions. There are no words to explain this unspeakable act of violence and why this would happen in a world formed by God for the beauty and the enjoyment and the delight of all of creation. And so without even trying to understand, we go to Scripture and to the words where St. Paul in 2 Corinthians invites us to call on the God of compassion and of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort that we ourselves have received from God. Dear God, as we gather here today, we pray your comfort, your healing presence for all of those who have been shattered by these events. Hear us as we pray. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our reading today comes from Luke chapter 24, reading from verse 13. And thank you to the Luma Project for their presentation of Scripture.
Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleophas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are. and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread.
This is God's word. May we be blessed to receive God's word as God intends. Amen. Scholars confidently link our awareness of Christ's presence to our gathering together. We know that God is omnipresent. We know that God is everywhere, all the time, like the air. But like the air, we need to engage. We need to open our airways. We need to allow our diaphragm to draw down air into our lungs, breathe, before we're able to benefit from this air that's all around us. In the same way, there are things that we are invited to do to engage with the living presence of God. This text picks up on some aspects of those. Luke tells of those two disciples who were walking the 7 miles between Jerusalem and their hometown of Emmaus. And as they were walking, we're told that they were struggling. They'd probably gone to Jerusalem for the Passover festivals. And while they were there, they would have seen the Palm Sunday entry of Christ on the donkey, fulfilling the prophecy of Zechariah, and their hopes would have surged. The Messiah, the long-awaited Messiah who was going to bring political liberation from the scourge of Roman oppression, getting their hopes up and shouting their hosannas probably along with everybody else. But then they had seen how their religious leaders had been threatened by him and had him killed. And with him had died all their hopes of a national political liberator. Why did he have to die? And what did all these latest rumors of resurrection mean? While they were talking and walking and discussing and struggling to come to terms with all of this, we're told that Jesus appeared with them, although they never recognized him. They did pour out their hearts, though, to this kind, this curious stranger. All their disappointment, all their disillusionment just came pouring out, and he listened. And having listened to them, Jesus reformed their experience, represented their experience to them, but in the light of Scripture. He presented to them that these things happened in fulfillment to prophecies that had happened over the last hundreds of years, and that, yes, Messiah, expectations, yes, but not political liberation, something infinitely more effective, something infinitely more powerful. We know that as he spoke, it was good for them. Because when they came to the town of Emmaus, where they'd be heading, and Jesus made to go on, they stopped him and they said, "No, please stay with us." And he did. It was only while they were eating supper, with the taking, the breaking, the sharing of bread, that their eyes were opened and they recognized him. This is Jesus Christ, and he had been with them all along. I'm left especially curious about three aspects of this narrative. The first is that we're specifically told that they were together. As they were walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus, and as they were wrestling these things through, they walked together, and it was while they were together that Christ appeared with them, even though they never recognized him. There's something absolutely essential about our gathering. Not being alone. Remember Matthew 18 verse 20, the way Christ put it, "Wherever two or more are gathered in my name, I am there." We are meant for community. Unless there's something wrong with us, some mental health issue perhaps, like an agoraphobia or something, we need community. Even the worst introverts amongst us are struggling during the social isolation of COVID-19. We need one another. We need one another for our psychological health, for our mental health, our emotional health, and we need one another for our spirituality. In Genesis, the narratives are clear. It is not good for humanity to live alone. We are made in the image of a Trinitarian God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, this relational aspect of the divine, and made in that image, we are communal beings. There's something in us that yearns for community, a community connection with our God and with one another and with all of creation. This mystical unity of everything. We long for that. We yearn for that. And so like Cleopas and the other disciple, it's no stretch for us to imagine that. It was as that they were together, speaking about Christ's things and wrestling the stuff through, that Christ came and appeared with them. Even though they never recognized him, Christ was there. The second thing is that it's not only that they were together, that they were together around Scripture. Scripture was involved. We're told that the whole struggling to make sense of things was brought into the light of Scripture, God's Word. Can we take a moment to think about the power of Scripture? The gift of the Bible, the gift of God's Word given to us. Something that we chew on, that we gnaw on, that we wrestle with, that we sometimes get to understand, glimpse truth through. Most of the time, I think we host and, but are always blessed by. I know the wisdom that says that the finger that points to the moon is not the moon, or in our case, the Scripture that points to God is not God. We don't worship Scripture, we worship God. But we have something about bringing our experience into the light of Scripture that releases our experience of truth beyond what we could do on our own. So summing up so far, they were together. Even during this time of pandemic, we need to find creative ways of getting together, of being together. Those disciples were together. Christ appeared with them, and they were together around Scripture. Christ brought the experience into the light of Scripture. There's something happened around the Word that reinforced his presence amongst them. I think that perhaps is one of the main reasons why we come together on a Sunday morning. The gift of being together and together in the Word, around the Word, finding truth in this most very, very powerful way. Anyway, these disciples wrestling, talking, Christ with them. It must have been life-giving, because as they came to Emmaus and Christ was making to go on, they said, "No, stop, stay." And he did. And then it was in the bread, the taking of bread and the breaking of bread and the sharing of bread, that their eyes were opened and they recognized him. And that's the third point, that it was in the taking and the eating of bread It wasn't just in Jesus walking and talking and explaining, but in the actual physical taking of bread and putting the bread inside of them, sharing of bread. I'm curious that the act of eating is so powerfully revelatory. I'm curious that it's not only the intellectual discussion that matters. I'm curious that it's not only the logic that we so enjoy, backwards and forwards, talking, wrestling the things through, but it's in the actual participation with Christ that we are given to see Christ. It's when the word becomes organic, when it comes into us, when we allow ourselves to be open to receive, that it all becomes very, very personal. It's not only our acknowledgement of his presence, but our participation in him. Our allowing of him to impact our lives and to make his organic difference that opens our eyes. That's what empowers us to begin loosening the constraints of our ego selves to release an awareness of what is most real within us. I'm also struck by how, unless Jesus had been invited to stay with them, he wouldn't. He would have gone on. I find myself wondering to what extent this Christ is still walking with us through all of the different ups and downs of our lives, all of our circumstances, and we are just failing to recognize that he is here. Norval Geldenaes wrote, "If not invited, Jesus would have moved on, and they would have missed the inexpressible privilege of discovering that it was Jesus himself who had been with them all along." Is it Christ alone who is able to release within all of us everything of what we have been made to be? I think it is. When last have you invited Christ into your life to help you to become real, to become whole? I think that's a very real thing. It's too bad that the overly simplistic and cliched theology of the last century has beaten those words to death. And the idea of inviting Christ into my life is now somehow viewed with suspicion. What does it mean? They invited Christ to stay. For us to invite Christ to stay, to come, to draw closer. I think it's all about our longing, our intention to become who we've been made to be, our truest selves. And it's our recognition in Christ that somehow it's as we engage with the mystery of Easter, the mystery of dying and rising, that we become real. Until then, we remain stuck in our pointless, egoic cycle of greed and fear and self-obsession. And it doesn't end with us. Immediately those two disciples came to realize that it had been Christ with them all along. He disappeared. And their response, we are told, were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us? That same hour they got up and they returned to Jerusalem and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. All of this leaves all of us encouraged. One, to make sure that we don't stop gathering together. Even during this time of crisis and this time of isolation, not to stop gathering together. Making sure that we're not alone. If we don't have families in our homes with us, well then we need to be reaching out by the telephone. We need to be reaching out by email. We need to find creative ways of connecting with others. Because there's power in connection. Those disciples were together as they walked. We need to be together as we are going through this. Secondly, we are being urged to take Scripture very seriously. Come back to reading it. not only reading it, but wrestling with it. Wrestling with it, our life experience, and the scriptural narrative. As Karl Barth said, we go through life with the newspaper in one hand and the scriptures in the other, and in between those two, that interaction, that is where truth is happening. Take scripture very seriously. I thank God for Elaine Smith and the Bible study group that have continued somehow to meet online and to have that connection. I plan to be starting something soon as well, and if you'd like to be part of some kind of online Bible study, contact the office. We'd love to hear from you. The third thing is to continually invite the living Christ in, specifically to be inviting an awareness of who Christ is and what Christ is into your life. I don't know when last you've done that. But for us to be prepared to ensure that all of this is becoming very personal for you, very real, close, allowing Christ to draw out from within you all of what he has already made you to be. Come, dear God, in Christ, that I may be all of what you intend me to be. In this time, may it happen. And as we do so, may we, like those Emmaus Road disciples, come once again to feel the presence of Christ-given life burning, stirring, very real, closer than our breathing, making it possible for me to welcome my truest self home, to know who I am, and then to go and share in a way that makes our God smile. May that be our reality. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite you to pray with me. Dear God, thank you for being with us as we journey. You know our journeys. Thank you for being with us and within us as we continue to invite an awareness of your presence into our lives. And thank you for making us realize, or at least begin to realize, who you have made us to be. May our hearts burn within us as we acknowledge that we are not alone. May we pray your very special blessings on all who are struggling with that reality, who don't know who they are, and who are hurting as a result. We pray your very special blessings on all affected by all sorts of events that are going on in the world at the moment. The COVID-19 pandemic, those devastated by this Nova Scotia tragedy. You know, dear God, you know. In your mercy, holy God, hear our prayers. Now we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. We say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we go back to whatever is awaiting us this week, may we walk as those Emmaus Road disciples did. May we be together, may be increasingly aware of the fact that we are not alone, that Christ is with us. And as we embrace scripture and as we invite Christ's presence even closer, may we be blessed to be a blessing to others. Find creative ways of being a blessing to others this week. And as you do so, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you today and always. Amen.
once he walked beside me, like he'd been there all along. Not a stranger, but a father who can sense when something's wrong. And he answered all my questions, and he understood my fears that somehow vanished now that he was here. Can't you see? Spend the evening a few moments before he went his way. Then, like a host, he stood and blessed me, broke the bread and poured the wine. Then I knew there was something there I recognized. Speaks my name, I can feel something stirring in my heart. How his words ring strong and true, like a once familiar strain, and I know I'll never be the same. I can see who walks with me, I can hear who speaks my name, I can feel something stirring.